Hello, my name's Neil and welcome to today's episode of Retro For You. Let's crack on. Today on Retro For You, we're back on this, the Denise, the modern ITX Amiga board. And in this episode, we're hoping to complete the build until it's ready to boot. Huge thank you to PCB Wave for sponsoring this video. I've already installed the caps and resistor networks and now it's time to bring everything else together. From socket to chips and that all important first power on. So, on that note, let's crack on. We're back on this board and we're hopefully going to finish this week. Now, I have had some delays due to the intense heat we've had in the UK.
Oh, it's too warm for me.
He's just been mental, especially in the shed. So I've got these ICs here. Now these four ICs here go in U9, U10, U11 and U12. So what they suggest in the manual is to solder these directly to the board due to timing issues. It does say you can use sockets, but it is not recommended. So I'm going to go along with what it says in the manual and get them soldered to the board. So let's crack on and get them done. Before we jump into the video, a quick shout out about our sponsor, PCB Way. If you're looking to bring your electronics project to life, PCB Way is your one-stop shop for high-quality PCB manufacturing and assembly, with fast turnaround times and unbeatable prices as little as $5. They make it easy to get your designs made just the way you want, from custom materials to assembly services and even 3D printing and more. PCB Way has everything you need to turn your ideas into reality. Join myself and thousands of happy customers and start your project today. Be sure to check them out in the link below or at www.pcbway.com. So the four ICs are now installed and it's looking more like a mainboard. The next thing I'm going to do is to install all these sockets around here. This is going to be quite a big job with quite a bit of soldering, so I'm just going to crack on and get on with it. Two thumbs up for whoever mentioned it last week.
Later that same evening.
I'm at the point now where I'm going to install the SIM socket. Now you have to be careful with this because pin 1 is here and it seems that I've got sent two 72 pin SIM sockets and one of them, pin 1, is here and the other one, pin 1, is there. So I've gone off the drawing and I presume this is the correct way to put it in. Well, I hope it is anyway, so wish me luck, guys, because if this is wrong, it's not going to work. And I don't really fancy desoldering this SIM socket once it's soldered, so I'm just going to crack on with installing this socket now, and I'll probably do the ports along the back as well, just to get them finished. We're actually nearing completion here. So you see here now all the ports on this board, and it's different to the original Amiga. Now we do have now audio on a headphone jack. We've got the RGB here, which is the standard Amiga port, which I had to salvage off an Amiga. We've got the two joystick ports here, which we definitely need for the mouse and joystick. We've got a serial port here, a parallel port, but we've also got two PS2 ports, which is a bonus. Now, you may notice there's no composite output, but who needs that? Captain Commodore will be very happy. Okay, so this is almost complete now. There's just a few things to do. One thing being the power connector here, another being this supercapacitor and this crystal. Now I have a bit of a bugbear now because I was missing this supercapacitor and this crystal here. Now you know these components are very cheap, but when you want to come to source them, you can never find them. And this is where it annoys me now, because I got them from DigiKey in the end, but I had to pay, I think it was £15 postage, just to get two components. And in here you can see, I mean, I've got a couple of clocks and the supercapacitor, and that's it. I think all in all, it cost me 17 quid when the components themselves are only like 3 quid. So it's just crazy. Why we can't have somewhere in the UK just to buy these, I do not know. I miss the good old days of Tandy. So I'm just going to go ahead, get these placed in, and just hopefully then crack on with getting it working. So this supercapacitor does have a positive, does have a negative, and it's pointing towards a negative. So we'll just place that in place, just like so, and solder it from the top. One our last point now. Now I did want to get a black one of these, but I struggled to find one. So we're just gonna have to go along with a clear one. I would have liked a black SIM socket as well, but we can't have everything, can we? It's gonna work, hopefully. So we're just gonna solder this in now. This is the last piece of the puzzle, apart from the other Zoho 2 slots, but we don't need them to actually test the board and get it working. So we're just gonna get this soldered now, and then we should be ready to populate and test. Okay, now I'm gonna start by populating what I can. Now, that's me out of ICs now. All I need to do now is to get the chips off the Amiga board and start populating them into the board as well. Now, I think these are the serial drivers at the back. I'm not quite sure what that one is. I need to source that one. These two are for the PS2. I think I've got these somewhere. I just need to find them in a bag. And then obviously these Amiga custom chips, your CPU, etc., and your Paula, and that's your ROM, I think. So we're just gonna carry on now and get these done as quick as possible. So all the chips are installed, the Pico power supply is plugged in, the OSCC is connected up, and we're just about ready to flick this switch and turn it on. So here goes nothing, guys. I'm actually flicking switch, I'm shorting it, but at the moment it's not doing nothing. This thing is completely dead. Oh well, don't lose faith. I'm sure it's something silly. It's got to be something silly. Is it the power? Let's see. Have we got a power light on there? No, we don't have a power light on the Pico supply. Let's just get the multimeter and check. We've got power going in there. So I'm just about to test the voltage on this. So we do indeed have 12.3 volt going in, as you can see there. So I'm just going to do a bit more probing around and see what's going on with this thing, because at the moment it just doesn't want to work. It's not like this happens all the while on the show, is it?
Much later.
So I've been on the Discord, and what a great help they are there. They've actually given me some pointers to look at. Now, this Atmel chip here is the main chip that turns the thing on, etc. I've been looking at schematics, and we should have 5 volt here, which we do have, and also I think 5 volt down here, which we do have as well. So that's a good thing. But the thing of note is here is pin 1, which is a reset line. We're getting a funny voltage around 1 point something volt it's been reading. And now I'm getting absolutely nothing on it. But before I was getting 1.4 volt, which is wrong. I don't know what's going on with this thing. So what I've done, I've traced it on the schematic and I've removed this diode here, this D4, because I presumed that was something to do with it, but it's still not working. So I need to go back to the schematic and I need to have a look to see what the problem is.
Much, much later.
Now, thanks to the guys again on the Discord, I actually bought one of these, which is a USB to TTL. Now, you should be able to plug this in and get a readout onto PuTTY. But I think because I haven't got the reset line's being dragged low, I'm unable to get anything on this. All I get is a blank screen. So, again, I'm carrying on with this. I'm going to get there, hopefully.
Much, much, much later.
It's a couple of days later now, and I think I've actually worked out what's wrong with this. Now, if you remember, we had loads of these resistor networks here. When I put them all in, I spent my time, I double checked them as I put them in, and I thought, yeah, these were correct. I took my time soldering them, thinking, absolutely brilliant, I've got this spot on. So upon reading the BOM, I noticed there was two different types. There was bust ones and there was isolated ones. So this reset signal comes from R50. Now R50 should be an isolated 4.7k ohm resistor network. Me, in my wisdom, fitted a 4.7k bust one. So of course, that's where the problem lies. So I've had to get my desoldering gun. I've desoldered it. I have now replaced that, and we're about to give this a new test. Hopefully it's going to work. That is definitely a problem. I had the wrong resistor network in the wrong place. So if you are doing this, just check your resistors. Double check the resistor networks. The difference is one has a number 2 on it and one has a number 1. I stick a couple of pictures up here so you can see the difference. So we're about ready to turn this on and see if it works. Now, I didn't manage to build the memory. I've just not had time and the heat's been terrible. And also been diagnosing this thing. So I found some memory in my drawer which should work. So we're just going to stick that in. Pin 1 towards the sockets. So we shouldn't have a green screen. Hopefully this thing is going to boot. Fingers crossed, guys. OSCC is connected up. Let's give this a go. The power supply is plugged in. OSCC isn't plugged in. It's a bit silly, isn't it? That's why we got a blank screen. OSCC is now plugged in. We now have nothing on here, but we're just going to hit the two switches. I do see a blue light, which is looking promising. I just need to switch this to the right source. We've got some flashing screens. It's got the diagram in. It's looking promising, guys. Come on, you can do it. Look at that. It's actually running amazing. It's just so good when these things happen. Let me just switch it to full screen. So you can see it's running. It's picked up the processor. It's even detected the memory, which is absolutely brilliant. Now, I'm not going to do any more further on this. The main thing is we've got it working. There's going to be plenty more videos on this coming up because we have to install it into the case. We need to build the RTG graphics card, and also we need to build the LAN, but also I need to get some sort of storage in here, an IDE somehow, so we need to look into that as well. I do have some ideas, so that'll be coming up in future videos. Now, if you're here for the first time, please hit that subscribe button, and everybody, don't forget to hit the like button and give it a thumbs up. Check out my YouTube buddies down below, and also check out our Discord and come along and say hello to us all at the YouTube Retro Repairers. So on that note, on a happy note, it's actually working. I shall see you next time on Retro for You. See you soon, guys. Bye.